that's the beginning of the Android invasion. And this is Kani Ati, who's sort of the chief honcho of the Doctor Who fans. Kani, what's the name of the association?
The Doctor Who Appreciation Society. It's based in Britain, and it's recognized by the BBC.
Are you from Britain?
No, I'm not. I'm a Canadian, but I'm the president of the only overseas chapter of the Doctor Who Appreciation Society, group number 9.
Where's that, in Toronto? Or?
No, it's in Peterborough. I'm from Peterborough.
Peterborough? Yes.
I'm a Trent University student.
How many members have you got?
Here in Canada, we have around 15 registered, 25 prospective. The entire society has well over 1,000.
Really? And what do you do?
Mostly we're fans. We're very interested in the program. In Canada, it's primarily speaking to the people in Britain, asking them about the program, what it is we've missed, what's going on over there. They're 4 years ahead of what's being broadcast on TVOntario.
Well, I'll have to get you as a researcher to find out all the things I don't know about the background of it. What did you think of this episode?
I thought this particular episode I find very interesting because of the vaguely surrealistic feeling that it gives. You're always slightly off balance in this episode. You don't know what's going on.
What do you think is going to happen?
I haven't the faintest idea.
I'm fascinated by the robot faces. You know, the ones in white, when the first time we got a look at the electronic face, that was really young.
Yeah, that was very spooky. You know, you knew there was something behind the helmet, but you didn't know what it was going to be, and this guy turns around, there's nothing in there.
Yeah. Yeah. sorry. The other thing that's really intriguing is the business about the money. The new money, all the money being brand new, and that you start to get the feeling that this is a completely artificial village, but the people are obviously real,
yeah.
And yet they go into these funny,
it's strange
places.
Routine. Exactly, yeah. 12 o'clock noon, all of a sudden everybody starts acting naturally, chatting, drinking.
Do you buy the doctor's radioactivity explanation?
No, I don't think that really explains it all. I think he was reaching for an explanation to reassure Sarah, because he doesn't know what's going on either.
Seems to me he always has to have a wrong explanation first anyhow before he gets the right one, doesn't he?
I don't think he can stand being caught without an explanation, so if he doesn't know what it is, he makes one up on the spur of the moment.
I think that's about the case. What about the business of that lorry full of people that was brought in originally, you know, the way they're sitting there?
Yeah, that was when you really started knowing that there was something wrong here, because, of course, they were all sitting there completely stiff, and nobody sits in a lorry like that.
And then
like
the
shipment
the scene
of
in
store
the bar
dummies
sort of makes it clear that there's something...
There's something wrong.
Something
yeah.
very wrong.
Something very wrong going on here.
Yeah. I wonder if they're real people.
Yeah, there's definitely something rotten in Devonsham.
Well, excuse me. Let's just get ourselves another cue for some of this. Sorry. What about the Space Defense Station? The fact that UNIT seems to have settled in there, but that the Brigadier is not there, and this strange guy with the eye patches running all over the place.
Yeah, of course, we haven't seen the Brigadier for some time, and everybody out in the audience sort of went, oh, wow, Brigadier Lethbridge Stewart, because we haven't seen him for such a long time.
Of course, the people who've just started watching this year have never seen the Brigadier at all.
At all, yeah.
Yeah, UNIT, maybe you should tell people something about UNIT and who the Brigadier is.
Ah, well, UNIT is the United Nations Information Task Force. It was created as the result of an attempted invasion by the Cybermen.
What year was that?
That was in, I don't know, that was in the late 60s.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That early.
You mean it's already happened? Oh, are you talking about when it was on the air or when the invasion happened?
The invasion happened in the late 60s.
Really?
That was when it was broadcast, and that was when it occurred.
Well, it's a shame we all missed it, eh?
Yeah, it was a story with Pat Troughton as the doctor. So the UN formed a task force to deal with any kind of alien contact, friendly or unfriendly. And since the then colonel Lethbridge-Stewart had been involved in two alien invasions, which he was mixed up with the Doctor. He was chosen to be the head of the British section of UNIT. The assumption is that UNIT exists in other countries as well. They're constantly referring to UNIT HQ in Geneva.
Uh-huh.
And he's a very good friend of the Doctor.
I didn't realize the UNIT was started that early. It must have been a secret organization to begin with, since here we are in the 70s.
It is a secret organization.
Right? And we've never heard of it outside of Doctor Who.
The main headquarters is generally disguised as a section of the Old Age Pension Commission.
Actually, new viewers this year, you will be seeing Colonel Lethbridge-Stewart pretty soon. He'll be back on the scene. Usually, we have him right along with the Doctor, coming and going in every adventure, but we will be getting back to him soon.
That's fine.
Yeah.
That's fine. Yeah.
What is he? He's not in this season at all.
I think he is.
No, I
was careful to say soon.
Yeah, well, you see, the only two which occur in present-day Earth, and this is the 13th season, I think, is the android invasion.
No, he's in this episode.
Of the android invasion?
Yeah,
no.
At the end.
No, he doesn't show up at all. They bring in somebody else from
Geneva.
Okay,
he's in the seats of doom.
We're just going to take cutaways of you, Connie, looking
okay.
at Judith.
Right.
Looking so interested.
Yes.
Yes, Judith is talking. Keep recording, please.
Okay.
And you can nod in agreement.
Well, where do you get that?
Okay, the next thing I'd like you to say is, for this interview, what did you think of this episode?
What did you think of this episode?
And now I'd like you to say, what do you think is going to happen?
What do you think is going to happen?
And I would like you to ask her or say, the other thing that's intriguing is the thing about the money, and then I'd also like you to say something about the villagers, some question about the villagers. You actually amalgamated those two things when you said this to Connie, but I can get into...
I'm not sure what you want, something
well,
about the village.
Well, let's do it first. The other thing that's intriguing is the thing about the money. Let's just ask that.
Well, the other thing that's intriguing me is the thing about the money.
And now would you say, and how about the villagers? What do you think is going on there?
And how about the village? What do you think is going on there?
And this time, what about the Space Defense Station?
And what about the Space Defense Station?
And there was one thing you asked, Connie, maybe you should tell us about UNIT.
Yeah. Why don't you tell us about UNIT? Explain the background.
Good. Now we'll just take a few moments of you just looking at Connie. And stop tape, please. Thank you.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hi. Jackie Ward here and Dean Shuring are both members of the Doctor Who Appreciation Society here in Canada, and they've just previewed The Brain of Morbius first episode with me. Say something.
Well, basically, I was rather impressed with some of the humor in this particular episode, especially with Solon trying to...
All
keep
the
doctor's head from getting damaged.
His first look at the doctor, and what a great head.
Exactly.
That was a nice moment, right.
I imagine if the doctor had been awake at the time, his ego would have gotten a terrific boost from it.
Listen, since you people are all steeped in the history of Doctor Who, I would like to know a little bit more about Morbius.
Morbius was one of the
quite a few renegade Time Lords.
Renegade Time Lords? I thought the Doctor was the only renegade Time Lord.
No, there have been several floating around. What, about four?
At least. Mm-hmm. One of them, for example, in the very early history of Doctor Who, one of the first adventures was known as the Menacing Monk. And
the Medicine Monk.
menacing.
The Menacing Monk,
yes.
Right.
And, the Meddling Monk. We'll have to change that, I suppose. The Meddling Monk. And he invaded, in effect, Earth at 1066 and tried to introduce modern weapons, and the Doctor had to stop him. But this was a very early adventure of the Doctor.
Mm-hmm.
In more recent times, he's had to deal with Omega. I would think that many of the viewers remember from the Three Doctors, who was one of the very Time Lords in the early history of the Time Lords, who was one of the solar engineers and who went mad and who tried to get revenge on the Time Lords. Another one of the more popular and recurring renegade Time Lords, of course, is a Master, who appeared in a few early Doctor Who episodes. And I'm
about
sure,
2 years ago,
yes,
I think.
Yeah. Yes, and he was a contemporary of the Doctor's, and he was, his motivation was basically power.
What about Morbius himself? I mean, do we know anything more about him than just this episode has shown us, or?
Well, it's the first time he's appeared, I
yes,
believe.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any, I know there are all sorts of interpretations and studies and whatnot, mm-hmm, that have been written, sort of backing up the things that actually appear in the programs, without giving away, in case you know, what's going to happen in the rest of this adventure. Mm-hmm. Is there anything more you can tell us about Morbius? Because I'm really fascinated at this, you know, we've seen the head, and we've seen what looks like a body that has something to do with Morbius, since apparently Solon is looking for a head for it.
Yeah, he seems to have been a very powerful Time Lord,
uh-huh,
one of the upper echelons. Time Lord planet.
And I think another interesting thing is the fact, from this particular episode, the fact that Solon describes the Time Lords as being weak and spineless seems to indicate that his master, Morbius, was someone who was attempting to lead the Time Lords on a more dangerous course, perhaps taking over planets or dominating, whereas the Time Lord philosophy, which even the Doctor, in fact, himself rebelled against, was that of non-interference.
Mm-hmm.
Although I think that the Doctor's motivations and Morbius's motivations are rather different.
Well, I suppose obviously that depends on who you are, which motivations look good to you.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure Morbius didn't care much for the Doctor's. The other thing in connection with the morality of the Time Lords and, you know, the situation they hold is the introduction of this sisterhood. It's the first time that we've seen a group that seems to have an ongoing relationship with the Time Lords, more or less as their equals.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a suggestion that the Time Lords aren't quite as above it all, even the official group, as mm-hmm we thought before, with the idea that the sisterhood fears attack from them. Any thoughts on that?
Well, I do know personally from much later adventures of the Doctor that the Time Lords had in the distant past had a different policy of helping other planets,
mm-hmm,
and cultures. And I think there, for some reason, they were turned off that for some reason.
Do you suppose the finance minister decided that foreign aid was no longer within the budget?
Well, I don't think it would be.
The cost of time travel must be quite phenomenal.
Yeah. I don't know if it would be so much that as perhaps they got their fingers burned. You remember, there's so many, even in our own world, there are so many countries who like to give foreign aid, and sometimes the results of that are not exactly what that country wanted in the first place.
Of course, it also raises the question, if you give aid to another time in time,
mm-hmm,
whether you're going to change the whole situation,
exactly,
that you're in yourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I think probably that must be, maybe something like that happened when they suddenly discovered that half the Time Lords no longer existed because they,
mm-hmm,
I mean, the old business, mm-hmm, if you went back into prehistoric times and killed a butterfly,
yeah,
that you might find out that your whole society didn't exist anymore.
A gun for
maybe
dinosaur.
Maybe that's what they're afraid of, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that reminds me, I was just going to mention, of A Gun for Dinosaur by
mm-hmm
Sprague de Camp.
Uh-huh.
The idea of any, even the slightest change of, in the past history, destroying the future.
On the other hand, if indeed you can travel through time, that would seem to indicate that you can't change it.
That's true, in a way.
Yes, the doctor mentions that, or he brings it up in the Pyramids of Mars, mm-hmm. about time travel and how you don't necessarily change it mm-hmm. by traveling back into it.
Exactly. Sarah asks him to take them back to the future mm-hmm. and not get involved with this horrible menace.
But in that case, it would change it. What mm. they did in the past was going to change the future because he said we can't go back to the future now. We must stay here, or this will happen.
Yes, he took Sarah to the future and showed a little sample of what could happen, and so I think that was a good indication of why the doctor is so careful and not trying to avoid crossing timelines as much as possible mm-hmm. in these various series.
Well, he also really tries to make sure that anything that's going to happen that might affect things is done by the people from that time zone mm-hmm. themselves, and
exactly.
that he himself doesn't mm-hmm. do it whenever possible.
That's right. In The Three Doctors, in a much earlier serial, the Time Lords brought all the Doctors together, but it was something that was almost unprecedented for them. It was something that they had to be very careful with, and I think that's kind of indicated of what could happen if anything went wrong in the crossing of timelines in any sense, you know, in the changing of histories. You wipe yourselves out.
Yeah, the other thing in this episode that really intrigued me was the way that the Sisterhood was able to move the TARDIS. Mm-hmm. And that's something we haven't seen before. I mean, there's been an occasional thing where mm-hmm. some mental power of some very, very strong mind could exert some drag or force on the TARDIS, but I've never seen a situation where it could actually be mm-hmm. completely moved. They must be pretty powerful.
I think it's basically something that they can do in combination, together,
yes,
combining their minds.
Well,
you've seen that in the past.
We'll find out in the next episode.
Exactly.
Thanks a lot.
Welcome.
Stop tape, please.
Jackie,
I'm just going to ask you to be looking at Judith, as though Judith was talking.
Are you saying something?
You can't actually say something, Judith, because we won't hear this.
I know, but when I do, we don't seem to get as good reactions, I've noticed. Fascinated by me moving my lips without talking.
And Jackie, I'd like you to look from Judith. Be looking at Judith. Mm-hmm. And I want you to turn from Judith as though Dean is it?
Yes.
Dean has started to speak.
Speaking.
Hello. How are you doing? This is wonderful to talk about Doctor Who.
And look back at Judith, please.
Look back at Judith and see what she isn't saying. And, yes.
And look back at Dean, please.
Mm-hmm. Oh, me again? Very privileged.
You're in the middle, so you get the most cutaways.
Yeah, isn't that wonderful? Mm-hmm. Oh,
look. Back at Judith, please.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Let's just take a shot of Dean while we're...
Okay.
So Dean is looking at Judith.
Mm-hmm. I was wondering what the strikes are
about. I
don't
want
your
lips
to
do. Okay.
And Jackie says something, so you look at Jackie.
I didn't say a lot in this one.
Actually, you're a marvelous talking trick, Dean, but you mustn't talk now. You must just look as if you're really interested.
Mm-hmm.
He can't keep his mouth shut.
And
it was
nod
great
at Judith as though you're actually agreeing with something that she said. Okay.
Little quick nods. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Okay. Stop tape, please.
10.
Just a moment.
Oh. 9.
He'll give you a hand signal.
7. 6.
You looking at you?
5. 4. 3. 2. 1.
Actually, the Brigadier doesn't show up in any of the programs of this season.
Start that again and say, actually, Judith.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
She's really looking this way at the camera, so you have to call her attention to it, okay? Stand by.
Actually, Judith, the Brigadier doesn't show up in any of the programs of this series. He's referred to in several of them, but he doesn't appear in any of them. I think that he was supposed to show up in this particular serial because two other old members of UNIT are there. I have a feeling at the last minute they couldn't get Nicholas Courtney, and they brought in another actor, gave him the lines, changed the name in the very final two episodes.
Okay.
Wow, that's what comes of talking to an expert. I'm sure she's right and I'm wrong.
Stop it, please. Good.